the image that was being produced in electron microscopy was mostly by what's called amplitude scattering, that is, by scattering of the atoms of the molecule of the object scatter the electrons. There was always an element, but we'd heard from Hugh Huxley, who was the, as I said, the leading electron microscopist. Well, that to get a better picture, you should defocus a bit. That seemed very odd, to defocus a bit. And it would be what's called underfocusing rather than overfocusing. And this seemed a bit of a mystery. Now, I knew the theory, and I could work out the theory had been worked out by lots of people, the very complicated electron scattering theory. But it wasn't that that led to it. It was the, I decided that what we should do is to try to work out the difference between how much was amplitude contrast, how much was phase contrast. Phase contrast depends upon simply a shift in the position of the diffracted wave relative to some standard, which you don't get in some scattering events. It's really too complicated to explain. But so people, now I wondered at this time how phase contrast arose. Zernike in 1934 was given the Nobel Prize for inventing the phase contrast microscope. Now what he did was to put a what's called a quarter wave filter in the path of the incident beam, which changes the phase relationship between the incident beam, which gets diffracted, and the diffracted rays. And this leads you to be able to see transparent objects. Now, I knew this, but I began to wonder how it was that people could use the microscope to see transparent objects in the 1890s, 1900. And it turned out that old microscopes, you could see much better these. You could see transparent objects or detailed information much better than you could in the more advanced microscopes, which corrected all the aberrations, the so-called famous Cooke triplet. I read quite a lot about optics and history of optics and realized that what was happening was that there was a mixture of phase contrast and amplitude contrast. And Harold Erikson was a postdoc who came to the lab, who was an expert electron microscopist. And we decided to study catalase, which is a simple two-dimensional crystal, to see if we could disentangle these two. And he did a series, a through focal series on catalase. And we discovered, I can't go into the whole details, the relative contribution of amplitude contrast and phase contrast. And it turned out that Hugh Huxley's recipe for getting the best pictures was to defocus by a very little bit. And John Finch discovered that that little bit had to be what's called 5,000 angstrom defocusing. If you defocus by anything more, you got very so-called sharp pictures, but they were false detail. The pictures of Robert Horn as one of the leading lights turned out to be, looked very striking, but it was full of false detail. And we analyzed this by optical diffraction, in fact. So Harold's work led us to believe that you could recreate or image a transparent object by a series of taking defocus pictures. You see, theoretically, a perfect phase object, perfect transparent object, you can't image at all. However, if you actually defocus, it'll begin, any kind of variations in the density of the transparent material begin to show up. And so that at least you can get a picture. And by this time, we'd introduced computer processing of images, which replaced optical processing, which I'd introduced. And you could then correct the defocused image in such a way to retrieve the original variation in density, giving rise to the phase variations. And so we suggested this. Now, this was the beginning of phase contrast underfocusing, which is now in totally common use throughout. There are other things as well, electron microscopy was a secondary scattering and so on, but this was the biggest factor.